you should soon be able to see Squim Bay, which is another inlet of the Strait of Juan de Fuca, to your right. The little community of Blin lies to the right of the road at the head of the inlet. Next to the bay in Blin lies the Jamestown S'Klallam Indian Tribal Center. The center is situated on a tiny piece of land that is also the Jamestown S'Klallam's reservation. Next to the highway is a viewpoint with a little kiosk which displays artistic carvings by tribal members. An attractive collection of totem poles by contemporary Northwest Indian carvers is displayed in front of the Jamestown S'Klallam's casino on your left, about a half mile past the tribal center. The Jamestown S'Klallam's are part of the much larger traditional nation of the S'Klallam people. Their traditional lands consisted of most of the northern peninsula between the mountain range and the strait, west of the Macaw territory at Cape Flattery and east to Puget Sound. Today they are divided into four communities. Three of them have their own reservations: the Jamestown S'Klallams, located here at Blin, the Lower Elwha S'Klallams, whose reservation lies a few miles west of Port Angeles, and the Port Gamble S'Klallams, located near Port Gamble, just east of Hood Canal's northern end. A fourth group went to live with the Tuana on the Skokomish Reservation and are now part of today's Skokomish tribe. In 1874, S'Klallam leader James Balch purchased 250 acres of land on the strait, about 4.5 miles north of Squim, and divided it up into private holdings for other S'Klallam people. In his honor, they named the community Jamestown. Many S'Klallam families still live there, and in 1980, the federal government finally recognized the Jamestown S'Klallam's sovereign tribal status. Elaine Grinnell is a member of the Jamestown S'Klallam tribe. She and her husband Fred live in Jamestown, where they operate a seafood business. Ms. Grinnell is also a professional storyteller, and she is one of the leading Indian storytellers on the peninsula. Here she explains the origin of the spawning chum salmon's hooked nose. As she speaks, you will pass Squim Bay State Park and the John Wayne Marina, where the late actor used to moor one of his yachts. It is now a public facility.
September, October, then the chum season starts around here, and they're running for the rivers. Now, they've come a long, long way. This one female with her companion were traveling, and oh, she was getting tired, and you could see that her tummy was getting full with eggs developing in her tummy, and oh my, it was important for her to get to her nest up the river, the Dungeness River, a matter of fact. She swam such a long way, and oh yes, they turned the corner and came past what we now know as Nia Bay, and she was getting so tired, and she said, "I will know my river when I come to it." And they kept swimming and swimming into the Straits of Juan de Fuca. And then pretty soon, yes, she said, "This is it, this is it." She told her mate, and as they turned the corner and they went past the spit and then up the Dungeness River. Well, they swam and swam, and oh my, she was getting so tired. And she said, "I'm going to have to rest." And he says, "I'll look for a deep hole where the current is just moving ever so slowly, and we'll rest there." She agreed to that. And so they stopped in this deep pool, and you could hardly see the water moving. Unfortunately, the next morning when they woke up, there they were down at the mouth of the Dungeness River again. And oh no, her tummy was bigger. Oh, it was bigger than it was the night before. And they just started swimming again. Up, up, up the river. Oh, they swam and they swam. And finally, when she got tired and her tummy was growing more and more, it was bigger and bigger than it was the day before. She told her mate, she said, I need to rest. He says, "I know what I'm going to do. I have a plan." Right around the corner, right up here, he says, there's this low-lying branch. And he says, "When we get to that branch," he says, "I'm going to grab a hold of that branch with my mouth. You grab a hold of my tail, and we'll just hang on that branch all night long and we'll swim, and while we're hanging onto that branch. And then, he says, in the morning, he says, we won't be far from the nest. Oh, that made her very happy. And so, yes, indeed, when they got around the corner, there was that low-lying branch, and so he went over there. And he grabbed a hold of that branch with his mouth. And she grabbed a hold of his tail with her mouth, and he hung on. Oh, he hung on so tight. And she hung on to his tail. And all night long, they just kind of drifted and held on to each other. He held to the branch. She held on to his tail. The next morning, she thought, well, I'm so close to that nest now. I can make it. Oh, her tummy was really big. She was in a hurry to get to the nest. And so she started swimming on her own, but she looked back over her shoulder and she looked at her mate and she thought something was different about him. But she couldn't figure it out what it was. And so she kept right on swimming and pretty soon he caught up with her. She laid her eggs in the nest and she looked over at him and now she knew what was so different about him. Why, from hanging onto that branch and supporting both of his weight and hers and just holding on for so long, it caused a permanent hook in his nose. And this is why even today the salmon has a hook on his nose. And so now you know how he got it.
You are now in the outskirts of Squim. If the day is clear, you may be able to see to your right a view of the Strait of Juan de Fuca. The dark hills over the strait are on Canada's Vancouver Island. The snow-covered mountain to the right is Mount Baker. The E in Squim is never pronounced, except by newcomers. Its name is derived from the S'Klallam word, ch-qua-ing, which means quiet water. North of Squim, a scenic byway, the Dungeness Scenic Loop, leads to the 5.5-mile-long Dungeness Spit, said to be the longest natural sand spit in the world. On the spit are located the Dungeness National Wildlife Refuge and the new Dungeness Lighthouse. The Dungeness Recreation Area lies where the spit connects to the mainland. The scenic loop also passes through the little community of Dungeness, which was once S'Klallam County's seat. The city of Squim is located on the Squim Prairie, which extends from the foothills of the Olympics north to the strait. Because of a meteorological phenomenon known as the rain shadow, the Squim Prairie and the adjacent Dungeness Valley to its west are the driest places in Washington west of the Cascades. The Olympic peaks interfere with the passage of moisture from the Pacific coast. Local resident Bill Herman describes it.
On your drive around the peninsula, you'll see areas where you get up to 200 inches of rain a year. Now, right here in the Squim area in the shadow of the Olympics, we get between 17 and 20 inches of rain. We average between 18 and 22 inches of rain. In Squim, it's 15 to 17, 18 inches. The Squim Irrigation District was the first irrigation district in the state. It's well over 100 years old. There are places down in the flatlands north of Squim where cactus is an actual native plant. So it's actually a desert down there.
Where the Forks to Port Townsend Olympic Discovery Trail crosses the Dungeness River in Railroad Bridge Park, just west of Squim, there is a fine interpretive display that explains the rain shadow and local agricultural and Native American history. Squim also has its own historical museum. The Squim Prairie and Dungeness Valley were once leading agricultural centers, and a tall 1945 grain elevator still stands in downtown Squim. If you drive north from Squim toward the Dungeness Spit, you will still pass fields of wheat and beans, but their area is much reduced. Agricultural land is still artificially irrigated in this region. Today, the vicinity of Squim Prairie and the Dungeness Valley is Washington's leading retirement community. Please pause the program until you come to the junction with Lewis Road to your right and Blue Mountain Road to your left. It will be about a half mile past milepost 257 in about 6 miles.